Let us pray. Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection sanctify your servants, from whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless, for those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away, and who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked, a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Though through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son, though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord. According to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden, into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter,
"You are not..."
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather, and in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
Is this the way you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered him,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
You are not one of his disciples, are you?
He denied it and said,
I am not.
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
Who did I see you in the garden with him?
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
What charge do you bring against this man?
They answered and said to him,
If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you.
At this, Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law.
The Jews answered him,
We do not have the right to execute anyone.
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
Then you are a king.
Jesus answered,
You say I am a king? For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
They cried out again,
Not this one, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged, and the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the Jews.
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And Pilate said to them,
Behold the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have the law, and according to that law he ought to die, because he made himself.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if I had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench, in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon, and he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
take him away, crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription, because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but that he said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
"Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be."
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate and their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled: "Not a bone of it will be broken." And again, another passage says, "They will look upon him whom they have pierced." After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Have you ever wondered what people were thinking as Jesus was being crucified? I'm sure some people were glad because they might have thought that this crucifixion would help keep the Roman soldiers from harassing all of them. Some might have been indifferent. This was just one of many crucifixions that they've seen. However, most likely there were some present who must have been devastated and brokenhearted. I often wonder how many people walked away that afternoon thinking to themselves, "I wish there were something I could have done." It's a bad feeling to feel that way, to feel helpless in a situation, not being able to have a say-so, not being able to be in control, that the outcome result is the opposite way that one hoped for. This was a man who did nothing wrong, a man who constantly helped people, taught people, comforted them, healed them, and yet somehow, some people, they were fearful of him, suspicious of him, and literally they hated Jesus. And even though some turned to him, Jesus was true to himself. Injustice, pain, suffering, being ridiculed, and even the possibility of death could not keep Jesus from doing one thing, the one thing why he hung on the cross, the one thing why God the Father sent the Son. The one thing is love, pure love. Nothing keeps Jesus from loving. That's who he is. That's who he is for us. And that haunting thought always comes back again. I just wish there was something I could have done. People, as we live in this journey, so-called life, we all have regrets. We all have those things in our lives that we wish were different. Times when we wish we would have acted differently. Times when we wish we would have spoken different words to someone who deeply cared, that we cared about. Times when we wish we had tried to do something rather than do nothing. Times when we messed things up through the choices we made in life. Times when we missed an opportunity to do the right thing, the best thing, the holy thing, but instead we did something that made us better, that made us better than that situation. And the words still come to mind. I wish there was something I could have done. I wish there was something I had done. Well, people, there is something we can do, and we can do right now, in your home or wherever you're watching this Good Friday service. It may seem very simple and basic, yet because we have been spoiled with the Mass, because we have been spoiled by God's Word, growing up with God's Word, and growing up as Catholics, we forget the simple things. All we need to do is just be grateful. Be grateful. To have an attitude of gratefulness. We can add nothing to Jesus' sacrifice, to Jesus' authentic love on that hill of Golgotha. Jesus dying on that cross stands alone. Jesus died on the cross for the substitution of our sins. And this was possible only because of God's goodness. So, the question is, was it good that Jesus suffered? Was it good that he died on the cross? And the answer is yes. Because it shows through Jesus Christ our suffering, our problems, and even, now get this, even our sinfulness has purpose and meaning. It shows that the worst sin is not the sin we do. The worst sin is not learning from our sins. Learning from our mistakes. Learning from our regrets. God's redemptive plan is shown perfectly through Jesus' faithfulness, through Jesus' obedience, Jesus' love for his Father, and his personal love, now get this, his personal love for you and for me. Jesus died on that cross with no regrets. Yes, he loves you. And maybe we don't hear those words enough from those that we want to hear it from. He really does love you. Or else he would not have suffered and died a horrific death that we just heard proclaimed in our gospel. That cross that we now adore, that instrument of death that we now wear around our necks, see in churches, wear as jewelry, and are in our homes, is a reminder of his love. He loves you. He really does. Now, let that sink in. He loves you. Let those words register in your mind, and let these words sink into your heart. Jesus loves you. He never gives up on you, and he never gives up on me. We give up on him. However, his arms are always open for us to run to him, to return to him. He always wants to rescue us, to keep us from drowning in life, to keep us from drowning with our problems. And here comes the devil, and you knew this was going to happen. Anytime you get closer to Jesus, that devil just wants to be there. And the devil says, oh yeah, sure, he loves you. However, you're living in sin. You're an alcoholic. You gossip. You stretch the truth. You say white lies. You have problems with your husband. You have problems with your wife. I know this. You have problems with your children, with your parents, with your grandparents. You have problems with your girlfriend and boyfriend. And you think Jesus loves you? The devil knows how to twist the words of Scripture. You're stuck on pornography. You're stuck on drinking, on drugs. You have addictions. You are a bad person and will always be a bad person. No one will love you. No one will ever love you, Satan says. You're not smart enough. You're not beautiful enough. You just don't have it. What we need to do is to look straight into Satan's eyes, and we need to laugh at him because of the wood of the cross. And we need to say to him, hey, God's not finished with me yet, because there is always the resurrection. God has given me the free will to turn away from my sins. God has given the Holy Catholic Church the sacraments of his divine mercy to free us from this stuff. His death has broken the chains of sin. And that scars that scares the shakamole out of the devil. That scares him the closer we get to Jesus. He has to run, and he does run, because love is greater than
any darkness than anything. You see, our loving God does not want us to be stuck in sin. He gives us the opportunity to rise above the sinfulnesses. We are part of his plan through Jesus. We, you and me, are part of his mission to bring about change first in ourselves, then our families, our community, even the world. To have no regrets when God calls us home, no regrets at all, that we gave it our all with Jesus Christ. And so, in a certain sense, through God's wisdom, this ugliness of Jesus' dying on the cross is the fullness of his saving act, which gives us meaning and gives us purpose. And this is it. God, this afternoon, is inviting us to share in his sacrificial love he gave us on the cross. And so we are the ones now, you and me, we're entrusted to make this love of God known, the love of God visible, the love of Jesus tangible to our families, our friends, our community that is desperately in need of this love. How do we all do this? Where do we start? First and foremost, we start by being grateful. We start by having a grateful heart, a loving heart, a forgiving heart, a generous heart, a compassionate heart, a merciful heart, a humble heart. That's the Jesus we have come to know. That's the Jesus we say we are willing to follow. That's the Jesus we, you and I, pledge to love. That's the Jesus who wants nothing more than to be our everything. And that's the people God wants us to be. He died for you and me. Jesus died for us. Imagine, I wish there were something I could have done. Well, there is. Let's start living as people truly grateful for the greatest gift God has given us, the gift of Jesus' very self, poured out for you and me on that cross, so that we are not locked, that we are not chained, that we are not caged, that we are not trapped into sin no more, no longer. As Paul says in Ephesians, for by the blood of the cross we are set free. People, no regrets. No regrets. We run to our Heavenly Father when he calls us home to him, with a smile on our face and Jesus in our hearts, and saying, Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I have no regrets. Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our Bishop, William Michael Mulvey, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayers for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their innermost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness for all of their sins through the waters and of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offerings, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the numbers of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased, as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, grant that those who do not confess Christ, that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you, come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will for the true peace and freedom of all.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, in whose hands lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace and freedom of religion, may through your gift be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because of their hour of need. Your mercy was at hand through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for a swift end to the coronavirus pandemic that affects our world, that our God and Father will heal the sick, strengthen those who care for them, and help us all to persevere in faith.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and merciful God, source of life, health, and healing, look with compassion on our world, brought low by disease. Protect us in the midst of the grave challenges that assail us, and in your fatherly providence, grant recovery to the stricken, strength to those who care for them, and success to those working to eradicate this scourge. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
At this time, if you have your crosses or crucifixes with you, you may go get them from your rooms or from the living rooms or your own personal cross or crucifix that you may have with you at this time. I invite you to adore the cross or crucifix on which hangs the salvation of the world.
Thank you. And at the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. May the receiving of the body and blood, Lord Jesus Christ, not bring me judgment and condemnation, but through your loving mercy, be for me protection in mind and body and a healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. May the body and blood of Christ one day bring you and me to everlasting life. Pray together our act of spiritual communion together. My Jesus, I believe that you are in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you beyond, above all things, and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart, as though you have already come. I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Your kingdom, Jesus.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, who has restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to bow your heads and pray for God's blessings. May abundant blessings, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son and the hope of the resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Tomorrow we will have the ending of our Triduum, which will be tomorrow evening at 8 p.m. We look forward to seeing everyone there as this Mass continues and ends tomorrow at 8 p.m. Saturday evening.